हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू निकुंजन राज ट्यूटोरियल्स। सो कॉन्टैक्ट नंबर फॉर एनी डाउट्स। सो टुडे वील डू फिजिक्स फर्स्ट चैप्टर, दैट इज मैटर। इन फैक्ट इन केमिस्ट्री ऑल्सो द फर्स्ट चैप्टर इज मैटर। सो आई हैव क्लब्ड बोथ दिस चैप्टर इन अ सिंगल वीडियो फॉर बेटर अंडरस्टैंडिंग। ओके, इट्स मी राज सर। नाउ फर्स्ट लेट्स डिस्कस व्हाट आर द टॉपिक्स इंक्लूडेड इन दिस। सो फर्स्ट वील डू व्हाट इज द स्टेट्स ऑफ मैटर, अ वेरी बेसिक चैप्टर। नेक्स्ट द चेंज ऑफ स्टेट ऑफ मैटर, सो हाउ द मैटर चेंजेस इट्स स्टेट। थर्ड टॉपिक वील डू काइनेटिक थियरी ऑफ मैटर। एंड फोर्थ इट्स समथिंग एक्स्ट्रा, लाइक दीज आर, see, we have studied three states of matter, that is solid, liquids and gases. But apart from that, we also have the fourth state of matter and the fifth state of matter, that is plasma and Bose-Einstein. So let's start with the chapter. So first, let's start with some important definitions and basics of the chapter. So first is, what are elements? See, elements is a pure substance. They are pure substance of simplest form, which cannot be divided into any other simpler substances. So here we have elements are simple form of pure substances, which cannot be divided into any simpler substances. Like for example, I have element here sodium. I have this circular shape of sodium with me. If I break this, let's say this is a circular shape, if I break it, it's kind of a stone. Let's say I break it, the two small pieces which I get will also be of sodium. There'll be no other element in those pieces. So it is purely sodium. When you break sodium, you will get two small pieces of sodium itself. So what they are saying is that element is a pure substance which cannot be divided into simpler substance. You cannot break sodium into two other substances. Like for example, if you have H2O, if you break H2O, you will get hydrogen and oxygen. So this is not an element. Water is not an element, H2O, but sodium is an element because you cannot divide sodium further. Okay. So let's read the definition again. Elements are simplest form of pure substances which cannot be further divided into other simpler substance by physical or chemical method. By physical or chemical. Physical method means by breaking. Chemical method means by doing chemical reactions. Next, the second definition is atoms. Atoms are the smallest unit of element. Smallest unit of element means what? Let's say if this is an element, this element is made up of small atoms like this, okay, which may or may not have independent existence but always take part in chemical reaction. See, when an element reacts with other element, for example, when hydrogen reacts with oxygen, okay, when hydrogen reacts with oxygen, basically what reacts is the atoms of hydrogen with the atoms of oxygen. These atoms actually react with each other. Okay, so atoms are nothing but the smallest unit of element. There is nothing smaller than an atom. Inside the atom, we have electrons, protons and neutrons. But further, if we try to go down, we cannot find any other element. Atoms are the smallest unit. Okay, they may have independent existence. Means what? Few atoms can exist independently. Few atoms exist in combined forms. And they always take part in chemical reactions. Okay. Now, next is molecules. Just a second. Okay, now in molecules is defined as, it is the smallest unit of matter which has independent existence एंड पजेस ऑल फिजिकल एंड केमिकल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ दैट मैटर. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज मैटर. मैटर इज लेट्स से फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई हैव इन दिस ग्लास आई हैव वाटर, ग्लास ऑफ वाटर. सो दिस एंटायर लिक्विड विच इज़ देयर इनसाइड द ग्लास इज वाटर. ओके, इफ आई फ्रॉम दिस लिक्विड इफ आई टेक आउट वन मॉलिक्यूल ऑफ वाटर, वन मॉलिक्यूल ऑफ वाटर मीन्स H2O. ओके, इफ आई रिमूव दिस वन मॉलिक्यूल ऑफ वाटर, दिस वन मॉलिक्यूल ऑफ वाटर विल हैव ऑल द फिजिकल एंड केमिकल प्रॉपर्टीज, ऑल द फिजिकल एंड केमिकल प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ वाटर. And it has independent existence, means this one drop of water can also exist independently. So what they are trying to say is that many H2O molecules, a lot of H2O molecules come together to form, see, a lot of H2O molecules come together to form the entire matter. Okay, so the entire matter is nothing but small units of molecules which possess all physical and chemical properties. Okay, let's go further. Now we have kinetic theory of matter, a very important theory of matter. Why kinetic? Because the atoms are constantly in motion. So there are certain postulates means certain observations which are stated about matter, and it is true for all states of matter. So let's see what are they. The kinetic theory of matter states that matter is composed of large number of small particles, individual atoms or molecules. So matter is composed of small particles. Let's for example, this is a matter. So this matter is consist of small particles like this. The entire matter is composed of small particles. Okay. Then the second is, molecules are in state of continuous motion. This is the most important point I can say. Molecules are in state of continuous motion at any point of time. For example, see, this is a matter and these are the molecules inside. These molecules are not stationary. They are constantly moving in this matter. Even if the object, let's say for example, this is a piece of iron. Okay. Is a piece of iron, so, and it is stationary, it is kept somewhere, but still the atoms inside this piece of iron are moving. Okay, if it is in a solid state, then they are vibrating at their mean position. If it is in liquid state, then they are moving inside the liquid, but they are in constant motion. Okay, so here we study an important point. That point is that molecules are always in a state of motion. Okay, now let's see the next point is in the first point the small particles was important part. In the next point we have continuous motion. Now in the third point the kinetic energy increases or decreases with an increase or decrease in temperature. Means the kinetic energy increases if the temperature increases. Understood? If the temperature increases, see, so you have to understand that the temperature increases means particles gets more energy, and because of that energy their kinetic energy increases. What is kinetic energy? Kinetic energy means their motion increases. Okay, their motion increases, they start moving randomly, rapidly in an energized state. Okay, so basically temperature has a positive effect on kinetic energy. If temperature increases, kinetic energy also increases. Okay, next point is molecules attract each other. Molecules always attract each other. This attraction is maximum in solids. Okay, this is called as force of attraction between the two molecules, or it can also be called as intermolecular force of attraction. Okay, intermolecular force of attraction. Next is, this force of attraction are of two types. When the force of attraction is between the molecules of same kind, it is called as cohesive force or cohesion. When it is of same kind, it is called as cohesion. But when the force of attraction is between the different kinds, it is called as adhesive force. For example, let's see this diagram here. Here, this blue are nothing but droplets of water. Two droplets of water are in contact with each other. They are both of same kind. They are of same kind means the force of attraction between them is cohesive force. Okay, but here you can see there is one droplet of water and one piece of leaf which I have made. Okay, so this is leaf. So this, the water settles on the leaf also. So there is a attraction between this water and this leaf. This attraction between two different kinds of elements is called as adhesive force. Okay, so make note of it. These are very two important parts. Next, the empty space between two molecules. The empty space between two molecules is called as intermolecular space. For example, let's say if these are the molecules like this. Okay, if these are the molecules placed like this. So you can see that there are here space here, empty space left here. So this empty space is nothing but the intermolecular space. This is nothing but the intermolecular space. Now there is one relation given here. That relation is, if the intermolecular force of attraction increases, see, the intermolecular force of attraction increases, the intermolecular space decreases. Means what? For example, if there are two elements here, if their force of attraction increases, they will move towards each other, they will come closer to each other. And if they come closer to each other, the space between them, this is the space between them, this space is decreased. If they come further close to each other, like this. So see here, in the first case, you see that the space was this much. Second, the space decreased. And third, the space further decreased. So basically, the intermolecular space will decrease if the force of attraction increases. Okay. Next, the states of matter. They are very basic states of matter, where you can see solids, liquids and gases. The density of solids is maximum because the particles are very close to each other. Okay. In liquids, you can see the particles are moving in a random motion and there is space between them. But in gases, you see, they are very fluid. They can go anywhere. They will not even stay in this container. If the container is open, they will move out of the container. And the space between the particles is very high. So let's see the difference between the solids, liquids and gases. So here is the difference between solid, liquid and gases. First is, solids are rigid. Okay, so solids are rigid. This is the most important point. Liquids are not so rigid and gases are not at all rigid. Second point we have, that solids have definite shape and volume. Liquids have definite volume, but they do not have definite shape. Okay, see, liquid take the shape of the container. If, for example, in a container I pour some liquid, if the container is in rectangular shape, the liquid will also get this shape. If the container is like this, the liquid will also get this shape. So the shape of a liquid depends upon the container. But in solids, it is not so. Object has their own shape. And in gases, there is no shape. It can go anywhere. So solids can't be compressed. See, solids, we cannot compress solids. Why? Because it doesn't have intermolecular space. But liquids can be compressed and gases can be highly compressed. Okay. Now the force of attraction. If we see the force of attraction between solids is very strong. Solids have a strong force of attraction. Liquids have intermediate level. Intermediate level means medium force of attraction. But in gases, the force of attraction is very weak. Now, the solids have very high density, intermediate density and low density. Simple point, solids cannot flow, but liquids can flow and gases can also flow. Diffusion rate. What is diffusion rate? Diffusion rate means spreading in air. When something spreads in air, it is called as diffusion. So the solids never spread in air, so there is no diffusion here. In liquids, there is certain amount of diffusion. It is moderate. But in gases, there is very high diffusion. Okay. Next, let's see the phase changes of matter. Here we can see there are three important states of matter: solids, gases and liquids. So when a solid melts and changes into liquid, we call it melting. Okay, when a solid changes its state and it becomes liquid, we called it melting. When the liquid changes into gas, it is called as evaporation. Each of these terms, we'll study each of these terms with definition in the further part of the video. So first let's understand, from solid to liquid is melting, from liquid to gas is evaporation. Now let's take reverse, from gas to liquid is condensation. What is condensation? Condensation means when gas becomes water droplets. The most common example of condensation is clouds. How clouds give you rainfall. So these clouds nothing but the gases which turn into liquid and come down as rainfalls. Then we have liquid to solid. Liquid to solid is freezing. Like when we get ice in our refrigerators, we fill the ice tray with water, and after some time we can find ice cubes there. So that is because of freezing. And now these two are most important, which are different from others. That is, a solid can directly become gas. It will skip this part of becoming liquid and can directly become gas. This is called as sublimation. Okay, when solid directly becomes gas. And when gas directly becomes solid, when the gas directly becomes solid, it is called as deposition. Okay, the another name for deposition is desublimation. So these names are important. Let's see the definition of each of these. First is melting or fusion. So it is a physical process that results in phase transition of substance. Phase transition means change of substance from solid to liquid state. When a substance changes from solid to liquid state, we call it melting. And why does it happen? Because of the application of heat or pressure. Always remember, all the change of state is because of heat and pressure. Okay. Next is freezing. Freezing is also called as solidification. Okay. Freezing is also called as solidification. It is the change in which a liquid turns into solid. Liquid turns into solid. Freezing. Now this is when the temperature is lowered. Okay, see, melting is done by increasing the temperature. Freezing is done by decreasing the temperature. So most of the time you have to know that for all substances, mostly all substances, the melting point and the freezing point is same. Like for example, at 0 degrees Celsius, at 0 degrees Celsius, ice turns into water, and at 0 degrees Celsius itself, water will turn into ice. So if I am heating, ice will turn into water. See, ice will turn into water. But if I am decreasing the temperature, this water will turn into ice at the same temperature of 0 degree Celsius. Okay. Next is evaporation. So what is evaporation? It is a process in which liquid state changing to gaseous state due to the increase in temperature. See, you have to understand, evaporation is not at boiling point. Evaporation can take place at any point only because of the increase in temperature. Why does this happen? We'll see in the further part of the video. But the most important that evaporation takes place due to increase in temperature. Okay, when liquid changes to gaseous state. Okay, next is sublimation. We've already seen what is sublimation. Directly solid directly changes into vapor. That is sublimation. And what is deposition? Deposition is also called as desublimation. Deposition is also called desublimation when directly changes from gases to solid state without going through liquid phase. Okay, so there are examples also in the textbook, you can read them easily. Now what is evaporation? Again, changing of liquid into gas below the boiling point. I have again written this information because I want to highlight here that evaporation is a process of liquid changes into water below the boiling point. Okay, at boiling point we have vaporization. Okay, at boiling point we have vaporization, but below the boiling point we have evaporation. Okay, so this difference must be known. Next, condensation. Again, I'll repeat, condensation is what? When gas changes into liquid, again due to decrease in temperature. Okay, next. Now let's study in deep, get a deeper understanding of what is evaporation based on kinetic theory. Kinetic theory. So what is evaporation? See carefully. Here, you see that this water here has water molecules throughout its area. Okay, but the water molecules which are present on the surface, these water molecules which are present here on the surface, why they are on the surface? See, in a liquid, let's say this is a liquid, okay, and there are water molecules which are present here. So these water molecules which are present on the surface have high kinetic energy, and if I apply heat from the bottom, okay, these particles which are there on the surface will get energy immediately, and once they get energy, that is heat energy, their kinetic energy increases, because of which they break free from the surface. So what is evaporation? Even below the boiling point, these particles which are there on the surface get energized and they break away from here. They break their bonds, they overcome the cohesive force and they move in the air. Okay, but in boiling it doesn't happen. See, evaporation happens only on the surface, but boiling happens throughout the liquid. So boiling happens only when the temperature has reached the boiling point. Okay, and all the particles behave in the similar manner, but in evaporation only the particles which are at the surface behave differently. So let's read out evaporation. The average energy of the particles in the liquid is governed by its temperature. See, greater the temperature of the liquid, greater is the energy. Temperature gives energy to the molecules. Okay, it means that some have higher than the average and some have lower than the average. What they are saying is that in evaporation, during evaporation, see, in the liquid, if this is a liquid, if let's say we assume this is a liquid, evaporation, the particle which is present here and a particle which is present here will have different amount of energy, but in boiling all the particles has same amount of energy. Okay, next. Hence, the more energetic particles on the surface of the liquid moving fast enough to escape the attractive force of holding the liquid together. Means what? That here these particles which are there, they are loosely attached from the surface. Loosely means weak. They are loosely attached with the surface. So when the temperature, when I heat this vessel, these loosely attached particles break away and leave this liquid. That is basically called as evaporation. Okay, they will go away from the liquid. That is called as evaporation. But you have to understand that evaporation takes place only at the surface of the liquid, okay? But boiling takes place throughout the volume of the liquid, okay? Let's see the next. Now, mostly the important part of the chapter is over, okay? Where we have studied three states of matter. We studied all the definitions and evaporation based on kinetic theory, okay? Now, these are extra topics in the chapter where they are teaching you what is plasma. See, we have seen three states of matter: solids, liquids and gases. But apart from these three states, there are two states which are there in less quantity, but they have great applications. Especially the plasma states have lot of applications. So what is plasma? Let's understand first. So plasmas are a lot like gases, but differ from gases, because plasma means when the particles are highly energized and they are in super excited positively and negatively charged particles. Means what? That if, for example, this is a plasma, okay, so it will have particles which are super excited. Super excited means they have a lot of kinetic energy in them and they will move randomly in one or the other directions. Okay, so they are super excited particles. They are very charged, and that is why plasma has a lot of energy and it has a lot of applications also. So plasma is created by a lot of natural phenomena. The most common phenomena is lightning. The lightning which happens creates plasma in the atmosphere. Okay, so what are the applications of plasma? Let's see some of the examples. The first, as we said, lightning brings plasma. Then sun, it is said that the molecules inside the sun have much more kinetic energy as compared to that of earth. So they are in a highly energized state. And that is why it is said that the sun has the energy, it is due to the plasma state which is there inside. Okay, next is nebula. This nebula is extraterrestrial. What does extraterrestrial means? Outside the space. These are cloud of dust. This nebula is nothing but the keywords, remember, clouds of dust. Okay, these nebula is clouds of dust. And for plasma, you must remember, plasma is very colorful. It has bright colors. So you can see this nebula also having a bright color, the sun having a bright color, as well as this lightning. All the neon lights which we see in decorations, in restaurants, in many other places, these neon lights, these are nothing but they have plasma in them. Okay, that is why they are very bright. Next is auroras. See, in Scandinavian countries, in Norway or in Denmark, in these countries which are European countries, North European countries, which are near the poles, these countries, in these countries we can see this phenomena which is also called as northern lights. These phenomena are called as northern lights, or they are called as auroras. What happens is that in the sky, beautiful patterns of different colors, different bright fluorescent colors are formed in the sky, which looks very amazing, and it is a big tourist attraction. So these are called as auroras, and these auroras are also due to the formation of plasma in the sky. Okay, so these are some interesting examples of plasma. Next, let's see. Next is the Bose-Einstein condensate. The full name is Bose-Einstein, and there is a word you must add here, that is condensate. ओके, बोस आइंस्टाइन कंडेंसेट, इट इज़ इन शॉर्ट इट इज़ कॉल्ड एज BEC. ओके, नाउ व्हाट इज़ बोस आइंस्टाइन कंडेंसेट? इट इज़ बेसिकली द फिफ्थ स्टेट ऑफ मैटर. सी, प्लाज्मा वॉज द फोर्थ स्टेट ऑफ मैटर. दिस इज़ द फिफ्थ स्टेट ऑफ मैटर विच वॉज रिसेंटली डिस्कवर्ड. दिस वॉज जस्ट प्रेडिक्टेड, इट वॉज जस्ट प्रेडिक्टेड बाय सत्येंद्रनाथ बोस इज अ इंडियन साइंटिस्ट हु अलॉन्ग विथ एल्बर्ट आइंस्टाइन इन 1924, बोथ ऑफ देम प्रेडिक्टेड, दे डिड नॉट डू एनी एक्सपेरिमेंट बेस्ड ऑन दिस, दे प्रेडिक्टेड दैट व्हेन एनी ऑब्जेक्ट इज सुपर कूल्ड मीन्स व्हाट? कूलिंग बियॉन्ड 273 डिग्री सेल्सियस, -273 डिग्री सेल्सियस इज वेरी लो टेम्परेचर, बिकॉज -273 इज कॉल्ड एज एब्सोल्यूट ज़ीरो. -273 इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज एब्सोल्यूट ज़ीरो. वॉट डज इट मीन? दैट सी, यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड द बेसिक थिंग फर्स्ट, दैट लेट्स से द टेम्परेचर इज 0 degrees. एज द टेम्परेचर फॉल्स, ओके, एज द टेम्परेचर फॉल्स बिलो 0 degrees Celsius, the motion of the particles decreases. When temperature is increased from 0 degrees, the motion also increases. So when temperature increases, motion increases. When temperature decreases, motion decreases. So -273 degrees Celsius means the minimum temperature that is possible, theoretically the minimum temperature that is possible is -273. So if you super cool a substance at -273 degrees Celsius, the particles will lose all their energy, because you are decreasing the temperature. When temperature is decreased, the energy of the particle also decreases. See, we have studied that when the temperature increases, the particles get more energy, but when the temperature decreases, the energy of the particles also decreases. This decrease in energy, because of which there is no movement also in the particle, and the particle forms clump. They all clump means they come together to form a blob. What does this mean is that the particles which are separate, they come together, they come close to each other. Okay, I'll draw and show you here. They come close to each other like this, okay, and they form a clump. They clump together to form a blob. Okay, so here you can see an example of BEC, Bose-Einstein condensates. This is where you can see the particles are very close to each other, because they are clumping and forming a blob. So this is how a Bose-Einstein condensate particle looks like. Okay, now as I said that Satyendranath Bose and Albert Einstein, they both predicted that at -273 degrees Celsius the particles will move differently, will behave differently. But Eric Conwell and Carl Wieman in 1990s, they created a Bose-Einstein matter. They created a BEC by achieving this temperature. So they were the first one who made a Bose-Einstein condensate by this temperature, decreasing to this temperature in laboratories. And that is why these two scientists, Eric Conwell and Carl Wieman, were also given Nobel Prize for that in 2001. Okay, this is very interesting, Bose-Einstein condensate. So here again, in this image I have compared all particles. This is solids, liquids, gases, and you can see here different state, that is plasma, and here you can see a blob formed due to clumping, that is Bose-Einstein condensate. Okay. नेक्स्ट नेक्स्ट इज लॉ ऑफ कंजर्वेशन ऑफ मास. नाउ व्हाट डज दिस लॉ इंडिकेट? दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट लॉ एंड इट इज सिमिलर टू द लॉ ऑफ एनर्जी, वेयर यू कैन से दिस लॉ स्टेट्स दैट मास कैन नीदर बी क्रिएटेड नॉर बी डिस्ट्रॉयड इन अ केमिकल रिएक्शन. ओके सी आई रिपीट, मास कैन नीदर बी क्रिएटेड नॉर बी डिस्ट्रॉयड इन अ केमिकल रिएक्शन. दैट मीन्स इफ यू आर रिएक्टिंग टू सब्सटेंसेस, लेट्स से ऑफ 10 ग्राम मास एंड ऑफ 20 ग्राम मास, देयर रिएक्शन टेक्स प्लेस, द आउटपुट वॉट एवर एलिमेंट्स यू गेट विल बी 30 ग्राम्स. दैट मीन्स दिस प्लस दिस विल गिव मी 30. सो द मास कैन नीदर बी क्रिएटेड नॉर बी डिस्ट्रॉयड. क्रिएटेड एंड डिस्ट्रॉयड मीन्स दैट वेन यू एड 10 प्लस 20 यू विल नेवर गेट 31. दिस वन एक्स्ट्रा विल नेवर कम बिकॉज द मास विच वॉज रिएक्टेड ओनली दैट मास यू विल गेट इन द प्रोडक्ट. ओके और इट विल ऑल्सो इट वॉन्ट हैपन दैट वेन यू एड 10 प्लस 20 यू विल गेट 29. नो इवन दैट इज नॉट पॉसिबल बिकॉज 1 ग्राम ऑफ मास cannot be destroyed. It may happen that it changed into some other form, but it never get destroyed. So what the definition says is that the mass can neither be created nor be destroyed in a chemical reaction. So the amount of matter cannot change. This is the definition, law of conservation of mass. Okay, I hope you have understood. Now, one more important point is the mass of reactants is equal to the mass of products. What does this mean? Mass of reactants is equals to mass of products. Reactants means, for example, if I have an equation A plus B, which gives me C plus D. So these two elements which I am mixing together are called as reactants, which they are reacting with each other, and these elements here C plus D is the products, that is called as the product. So whatever you get here on the right hand side is the products, and whatever you add, you mix, are the reactants. Okay, this is, so here the weight of A plus B will be equal to the weight of C plus D. So the mass of reactants will be equal to the mass of products. Okay, this was the learning from this statement. Let's see the next. Here we have a very good image which shows that how conservation of mass is maintained. You can see here log of wood. You have a log of wood which is 30 kg, and then there is fire. See fire. If you are producing fire using some substance, then there has to be the weight of fire also. So here you see that we are using 30 kg of wood and 1 kg of a substance causing fire. So when we are reacting them with each other, this wood and fire, the wood turns into ashes and there is smoke released in the air. See, the wood will turn into ashes and there is smoke released into air. If you capture this smoke and measure the weight of the smoke, and if you take the ashes and measure the weight of the ashes, and if you add both of them, you will get the answer equal to this. So these, the reactants which I say, these are reactants and these are products. So the mass of reactants is equal to the mass of products. That is the law of conservation of mass. Understood? See, states of matter is a very easy chapter, and certain basic rules you have also studied this chapter in your lower standards. So you won't find it much difficult. If you have any doubts, you can contact me. Next is the last topic of this chapter is Landolt experiment. This Landolt experiment is about the law of conservation of mass only, where he has done a chemical experiment to show that law of conservation of mass is conservation of mass is valid. So using what experiments? Let's see the experiment here. Here you see there are two test tubes which are connected with each other, and he has put two solutions here. This is the first one is AgNO3. AgNO3 is silver nitrate, and HCl is hydrochloric acid. So he is mixing silver nitrate with hydrochloric acid. Let's see the equation here. See, this silver nitrate with hydrochloric acid is mixed. What do we get as a products? These are products, these are reactants. So what are we getting as products? We are getting silver chloride and nitric acid. Now how do we get this equation is not important for us. What we need to know is that the products are silver chloride and nitric acid. Now when we compare the weight, if we add the weight of AgNO3 and HCl, AgNO3 is silver nitrate plus hydrochloric acid. Let's say I got the answer as 120. And after reaction, if I add the weight of AgCl and HNO3, I will again get it as 120. So these both weights will be equal, which justifies our experiment that mass can neither be created nor be destroyed in a chemical reaction. Understood? Next, another experiment they have shown in your book is 2 magnesium plus O2. Mg stands for magnesium. So when magnesium reacts with O2, O2 is nothing but oxygen. Okay, so this reaction is also called as oxidation reaction. It is also called as oxidation. So that oxidation, when magnesium reacts with O2, gives 2 magnesium oxide. So here in words, I have written, when magnesium ribbon is burnt in air, a white solid magnesium oxide is formed. This white solid magnesium oxide is nothing but this, because of which we burnt this magnesium. See, you have to understand, this MgO is formed because this magnesium was burnt, adding oxygen. Adding oxygen means you are burning, because always if there is no oxygen, there cannot be burning. Burning requires oxygen. So here when we mixed, and when we get the, when we calculate the mass of Mg plus O2 with MgO, we will get the answer same. That means the law of conservation of mass is satisfied. Okay, this is all in this chapter. See, we have done many important topics here. Let's take a quick look what all topics we did. So the first important definitions was, the first important definitions we did, elements, atoms and molecules, you have to learn them. Then apart from that, we did kinetic theory of matters. Kinetic theory of matters, see, there are several points here in kinetic theory of matters. These are the points. See, there are 4 points here and there are 3 points here. So all these 7 points must be done. Okay, so this is intermolecular force of attraction, this is cohesive force, adhesive force. These are the key points which I have marked, and this is called as intramolecular space. Then we have states of matter. Okay, this is self-explanatory. You all understand what is states of matter. Okay, then we have this distinguish between, where we have to learn each and every point, because anything can come in exam here. Then we have conversion of states of matter, where we studied melting, freezing, then condensation, evaporation, and in the end deposition and sublimation. This deposition is also called as desublimation. Like condensation and melting is also called as कंडेंसेशन इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज लिक्विफैक्शन. यू हैव टू रिमेंबर दिस. कंडेंसेशन इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज लिक्विफैक्शन. फ्रीजिंग इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज सॉलिडिफिकेशन. दीज आर अदर नेम्स. ओके, देन वी हैव मेल्टिंग, फ्रीजिंग, इवेपोरेशन, डिपोजिशन, कंडेंसेशन. ऑल दिस टॉपिक्स आर डन. देन वी हैव इवेपोरेशन बेस्ड ऑन kinetic model. So you have to remember this experiment, which shows that evaporation takes place only from the surface. The energized particles, when heated, their kinetic energy increases and they leave the surface. Okay, then we study next the fourth state of matter, plasma, where we studied what is lightning, sun, nebula, auroras in northern lights. Auroras are called as northern lights and neon lights. Okay, then we studied the fifth state of matter, predicted by Bose and Einstein and discovered first time created by Cornell and Wieman. Okay, so this is how a Bose-Einstein condensate looks like. Then we studied the important conservation of mass, that it can neither be created nor be destroyed. And then we did the last Landolt experiment, where we did silver nitrate with HCl and magnesium oxide. So when the magnesium was burnt, a white solid called magnesium oxide is produced. So this was all about the chapter. In the next class, we'll do a new one. Thank you very much, students. Good luck. Stay home.